coming out of the Casey Anthony case down in Florida. Officially right now, the defense has rested. The defense has rested in this case, folks. This means that there will be no new defense witnesses coming to the stand. The big news out of this, of course, is the fact that Casey Anthony herself, as you're seeing in live pictures right now, standing next to her attorney, Jose Baez. Casey Anthony will not be called to testify. Many legal analysts had, of course, observed that they believe she would not, in fact, be called to testify because, specifically for an appeal, an impending appeal, why would they give up any information about her testimony right now? Let's listen in to the judge.
Making you arrive at that decision?
No, sir.
Okay. And that decision is your decision freely and voluntarily?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. All right, let's return to jury.
All right, you just heard the judge say that the jury will now come back in. That's why everyone is standing right now. Let's go back out to our correspondent on the case, Phil Keating. Phil, I guess people will not be stunned at this news. Most people believed that Casey Anthony would never take the stand.
Absolutely. If she had taken the stand, she would have been up for the cross-examination grilling that has made Jeff Ashton with the prosecution's team so effective during the entire roughly 10-day presentation by the defense team. As expected, at least with us here outside the courthouse, Casey Anthony not taking the stand. And as I mentioned, at 1 o'clock, it is Florida law that the court has to have a direct conversation from the judge to the defendant to make sure that it is the defendant's opinion and belief and decision whether to not take the stand or whether to take the stand. Because in many cases, even if their attorneys, their entire legal team says, don't take the stand, if a defendant wants to and insists on it, it is their absolute Florida constitutional right. So now what we're gonna have here is the beginning of the rebuttal by the state. However, there have been some potential discovery violations, according to Jose Baez. But I can tell you out in the hallway, we've got several people ready to testify on behalf of the state to rebut some of the assertions and testimony made in the defense's case. A couple of people that work at Gentiva Healthcare, that's where Cindy Anthony worked back in March of 2008. She testified last week that during that time, while she was clocked in at work, she was really at the Anthony house on the home computer typing in searches on Google for chloroform. These witnesses are going to say, no, absolutely, she was not at home, she was at work. Also, a couple of Orange County Sheriff's deputies are also on standby to talk about those internet searches as well as the crime scene tech. If we can, we can take a listen to what the judge is doing right now.
Ms. Casey Marie Anthony, is this stipulation true and correct? Ms. Burdick. And as a result of that stipulation, do you intend to offer some documents?
Yes, sir. We intend to introduce the business records of Sure Tape, the Henkel brand duct tape.
And that is currently marked as identification numbered what, Madam Clerk?
FW.
And the defense offering that in the evidence, there being no objections from the state of Florida, it will be received in evidence as defense exhibit numbered?
Number 75.
Okay, Mr. Baez, you may call your next witness.
Your Honor, the defense rests.
Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, there are going to be some matters we're going to need to take up outside of your presence. It should not take too long, but I'm not going to run a guesstimate on how long it will take. So we will get back with you as quickly as possible. Please do not discuss this case among yourselves nor with anyone else. And please remember all of my previous admonition. Let's excuse the jury.
So you're watching live coverage right now of the Casey Anthony murder trial of her two-year-old little girl down in Florida. The defense has just rested, and I want to go immediately now to Judge Alex Ferrer. He's the host of Judge Alex. He's been watching this case daily for us. So many unanswered questions here, Judge, because especially in the jury's mind, they were never given any explanation about how Casey Anthony's father or brother sexually abused her, allegedly.
Absolutely. And I said from day one, Casey has got to take the stand in order to advance this defense. There's nobody else who could testify to the accidental drowning because it was denied by the father. There's nobody else who could testify to the sexual abuse because that was denied by the father as well. It was never asked of the brother. So she had to in order to advance the defense. She's choosing not to, which is going to make it very interesting in closing argument because the prosecution is basically going to cram that right down their throat. Typically, the prosecution cannot comment on the failure of the defense to present any evidence. However, when the defense opens the door by promising certain evidence in opening statement, the prosecution can respond, and we can expect that from Ashton later on.
Very interesting. Do you think then, if you were to analyze all of this, that Casey Anthony's attorney's goal here was simply to spare her from the death penalty?
Well, it could have become that. I don't know if that was their goal at the outset, but certainly one of the considerations you have to have is if you put her on the stand, and frankly, I said from day one, I do not think this is a death penalty case in the sense that I do not believe she will get the death penalty. That being said, if you put her on the stand and she becomes so unlikable to the jury, which she certainly could, because they've heard her lie over and over again and just put her family through all of this, they could change their mind and actually lean in favor of death. So it's certainly possible that the defense at some point said, let's work on saving her life. Mm-hmm.
Judge, give me a sense of a timeline here now, because we heard from our reporter down there, Phil Keating, that now the state will have rebuttal. How long do you expect that to last?
Well, I got to tell you, Phil knows the case probably better than I do, because he's covered this from day one and is in there all the time. My suspicion is the rebuttal case will go about a half a day. They may wrap that up today. If the judge wants to have the charging conference tonight, he can, and they could do closings tomorrow. But if he decides to leave the charging conference till tomorrow, then we will probably hear closing arguments on Saturday. The judge has said that once they start deliberating, he is not going to stop the deliberations for anything. So we can anticipate that they will be deliberating until they reach a verdict, even if that's July 4th or after.
Uh-huh. So closing arguments, are attorneys given a certain time limit on that?
So generally, in a case like this, the attorneys are asked. I always asked in a death penalty case, how long do you need? And whatever they wanted, they got. Because this is not the case where you want to be snipping minutes off of the end of a closing. I think both sides said they wanted half a day. So I anticipate that if they do it Saturday, it'll pretty much take the entire day. And the jury, if they finish late Saturday, the jury will be instructed by Judge Perry on the law right away and retire to deliberate. How long they deliberate, it's up to the judge and the jury. The judge sometimes says, I'm not going to make them stay past a certain hour. I used to let the jury decide. And I've had jurors who decided they wanted to keep deliberating, and I kept going till 1 in the morning. But that was only because they wanted to.
Right. Well, and this jury, keep in mind, has been sequestered for more than 30 days right now, so they may want to continue deliberating. I want you to listen again.
I think they'd like to get it over with.
Yeah, no kidding. I want to listen again to Casey Anthony's response to the judge just moments ago.
No, sir.
I have some questions I need to ask of your client.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Ms. Anthony, do you understand, first of all, is it your decision not to testify based upon consultation with your counsel?
Yes, sir. Okay.
You understand that your decision to testify or not testify is solely your decision and your decision alone?
Yes, sir.
And it is your decision not to testify?
Yes, sir. Okay.
Have you had ample time to discuss this matter with your attorneys, that is, the pros and cons of testifying or not testifying?
Yes, sir.
And has anyone used any force or pressure in making you arrive at that decision?
No, sir.
And that decision is your decision freely and voluntarily?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
So, Judge, let me ask you this. Is it ever a case where the lawyer would actually say to her, you know, we don't want you to testify, or we do, and then she would say no? Or does the judge just have to go through all those questions to try and not get to an appeal point of view?
The judge goes through all those questions. That colloquy is standard. I've given it almost exactly the way that Judge Perry gave it. But it's given in every single case in order to make sure that a defendant does not come back later and say, I wanted to testify and my lawyer told me he wouldn't let me and there's no way I could take the stand, or vice versa. My lawyer made me testify. I never wanted to take the stand.
But I will tell you this. I've had cases where the defense lawyers have said, I don't want my client to testify, but she's insisting. And you still go through that colloquy and you let them know, you know, your lawyers know the legal ramifications. They know what the prosecution's going to use against you and how you could hurt your case. You should listen to their advice and weigh it. But ultimately, the decision is yours. So what would you like to do? And you go with what they want.
But how will the jury look at Casey Anthony now? Do you think that they wanted to hear from her? And if they did, how will they interpret this?
Everybody wants to hear from her. I'm dying to hear from her. I'm sure the jury feels like, you know, wait a minute. How did you snatch this away from us? You promised us a drowning with father involved, and that he sexually molested his daughter, and that's what led to her basically becoming kind of, you know, in denial and not calling the police and all this, the excuse for her bizarre behavior after her daughter's death. They got none of that. They got absolutely none of that. And that, I think the jury is going to be wanting to know why. And Ashton is going to highlight it in closing. You didn't hear any of that. There's no proof of that. That didn't happen. And when in light of that, I think we're headed straight for a conviction. Whether it's first or not really depends on whether the jury believes that the duct tape that was found in front of the skull and that was attached to the hair was actually used to suffocate her by wrapping it around her, across her mouth. I think there's enough there for a first-degree murder, premeditated murder conviction. They could come back with that or with a felony murder or with any of the lessers.
You know, it's so interesting, Judge, because when you were up here in New York maybe 2 months ago or so, I interviewed you, and you pegged this exactly correct. You said that you believed that the defense was going to go after Casey Anthony's father, and that is exactly what they did. Even leading up today, I don't even know how many times he took the stand, but today they put him back on the stand to ask him how he used to bury his pets. And I guess that they're
ridiculous.
What they were trying to get across to the jury was that, hey, if he put duct tape over the mouth of a pet, maybe he did that to his granddaughter.
Yeah, but it wasn't about duct tape over the mouth of a pet. All he said was, all they asked him was the fact that he had buried his pets in a blanket inside a garbage bag, because Kaylee was found with her blanket inside two garbage bags and a laundry bag, and whether they sealed the bag or wrapped the bag in duct tape. Mm-hmm. That's apparently how the family gets rid of their pets. What I was shocked about was how many pets they've gotten rid of that way. Frankly, what I learned was do not let the Anthonys babysit your pets, because they buried maybe 7-10 pets, I don't know. But they didn't, but you know, the prosecution was able to get up and say, really? Did you ever chloroform your pets?
Yeah.
Did you ever put duct tape across their mouth? It was.
Judge Alex Ferrer, great to get your thoughts. Thanks for being there for us.